seconds here.
Well, today we're with Mr. Jack Dennison. Why do you have a copy of Mein Kampf in your basement?
As a matter of fact, I almost do. I've got a lot of World War II stuff that happens to be in, not Mein Kampf, but happens to be in the same general.
Yeah, I thought I saw Mein Kampf down last year.
Yeah.
You know, I was down there. Well, I've been waiting a year.
I thought that's what you wanted to talk about here today, you know.
Your affiliation with the Nazi Party.
Right.
We'll keep that quiet. If you happen to see this red light go off, let me know it went off when I was testing it.
Yeah, no, it's
all okay. Your full name, please?
Well, Jack Dennison, but John Chapel Dennison. Chapel being my mother's maiden name.
Okay, and what was the year of your birth, if you care to give us that?
That's easy. 1920? 1920. November 14.
Okay.
Not a particularly auspicious date, but... That's it.
Okay. What are your first memories of White Lake?
I suppose coming up on, because we came up from Chicago, although I came here first when I was a year and a half old, because I was born in Grand Rapids, I was coming up on the Michelinda Beach Road, which at that time was paved, but it just had one lane of pavement in the center. And then when you met somebody coming the other way, you had to get off to one side or the other. I don't know why I remember that, but I just happen to remember that.
Now, was this road the same road that you're talking about that runs now?
Sure, it's the same road that has been repaved several times, but it was repaved just in the last year. Same thing exactly, and it was always called, as far as I remember, the Michelinda Road because it went to Michelinda.
How did your family come to White Lake, first get here or start to come?
Well, my grandfather was a very junior partner in a law firm which included Wilson and primarily Butterfield and Taggart. And they, the Butterfields and the Taggarts and the Wilsons, I have always understood, received some land which is essentially from the yacht club up to what's now Pulvers, as in part of a law debt for doing work for the lumber company up here. However, my grandfather got the land that we have now later, and he bought it for I don't know how much money, in about probably about 1891 or two. Built the cottage. And Parsons built the cottage, who used to be over on, ran the hotel over on what's now Lamos Road, but it's Doug Partridge's grandfather, I guess. And they built the house, which has about five bedrooms at the time. It cost $600.
Can you tell us, you brought up something that I never knew about, the hotel you just talked about on Lamos Road. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, this whole area really got started into the tourism business after lumber went out completely and was defunct. And it started because the people that had farmhouses and so forth took in boarders from Grand Rapids, from Chicago, from all around. And gradually these got into sort of boarding houses, and one was the Partridges over there, was a boarding house. I remember the house, but I don't ever remember staying there. And from that evolved all the other things like Murray's Inn and Michelinda Beach Lodge and then Pigeon Hill and all the ones that are around the lake. So that the tourism business rather early became a big economic area here. Sylvan Beach, as far as I know, never had, like they had Murray's Inn. Oh yes, they had a hotel over there too. Murray's Inn and a hotel. And that's how the community really got around. They usually hired somebody locally who stayed year round. And
about what year did the lumber run out here? Did they stop cutting things down?
I don't know. I'm guessing probably the 1890. The Chicago fire took a lot of the lumber out, and Chicago was really completely rebuilt by 1892 when they had the Columbian Exposition, and from then on it went on out. There used to be, I don't know how many, there used to be something like 30 or 40 sawmills on White Lake alone. I mean, that was the industry. And that's how you got Sylvan Beach started, of course, because these people like the Covels, and well, the Covels are the name I remember, but just came over and had picnics in this vacant area over there, and then I'm sure the wives said, hey, it'd be kind of nice if we spent the night, and I don't want to stay in the tent, so why don't we build a little shack? And that's what they were, shacks, until all these interlopers came from Chicago and bought it out, and now you know, see what you have.
That's right. What, this law firm that your father was with, where was that? Was that out of Grand Rapids or Chicago?
Yeah, that was the old Butterfield firm, and Taggart, it was Butterfield Taggart, and it was in Grand Rapids. It was Grand Rapids. And that's how you had this, that's how you have the land that the Butterfields have. They had the land all the way from what's now the golf club up to Pulver's. And it was split between
the law partner.
Split between one daughter, Patricia, Champ Butterfield, and Ike Butterfield. And those are the three. So Jimmy now lives in what was Mary, was the other. Mary was the sister, and Patricia was married to Champ Butterfield. But there were the three lots in there.
Okay.
And that's where Jimmy Butterfield is now.
Okay. Was the house across the street, was that the original Denison Cottage, the one you sold and then moved here?
Yeah, that was built. That was built in 1894, and that's the one that had, I don't know, five bedrooms and a couple of sleeping porches, and it cost $600.
You're kidding. Was the cost of that?
Yeah, but of course there was no plumbing, no electricity in it. It was all lumber, and the lumber was free at this time, and it was built during the winter time when the Partridges didn't have, much of anything to do, and they really built it. And that's how a lot of your cottages were built.
Okay, I guess Doug Partridge might be somebody to talk to. Right?
Yeah, Doug would.
Doug would be good.
Doug should have a background. And this is all. Schiller's Barn must have been up at that time. Schiller's Barn was probably built before even the Partridges.
Was that a functional barn at one time? Was it farmland?
I don't know. Jim Lindrup has asked me to kind of look into it, and I've kind of tracked it down where it must have been built probably after 1860, and between 1860 and probably about 1880, because, no, it had to be later than that. Anyway, it had to be built after the lumber business stripped all the land, because it's a farm, it's a barn. Therefore, it couldn't have been built when there was a lot of timber up here. And it must have been built prior to 1890, because after that you had the farmhouses built, and they were all built after the barn was. So it probably was built between 1875 and 1885, something like that. But I don't know exactly when. Jim doesn't know either. But Jim did get, interestingly, the original deed for that property. And you want to turn it off?
Yeah. Give a second or two.
Okay, the light's on.
Good. Let me just make sure I got you in view. I didn't knock it or anything. Good.
John, just continue on this thing, because it's kind of interesting. I didn't get this, but I've got a couple of photostats of it. That is the original, it would be the original land grant for the property that was known as Crosby's Point, which is from the from about where we are here on east. And it's signed by Millard Fillmore, president, dedicating it to Israel Crosby, I think. So that was the start of it all here.
Okay.
At least in this area.
Okay, because we also have a land grant signed by Fillmore that takes the Knutson land from Lake Street, which was my grandmother's family.
Right.
Takes it from Knutson, from Lake Street into Muskegon.
Yeah, see, so they're all about the same time.
Fillmore,
all at the same time.
Yeah.
And they're usually big sections of land. And then, of course, they were subdivided down. The land over there at that Mishalinda is on belonged to, I've forgotten the names, but the O'Connells for a while, then to the O'Connells' grandfather, Austin. But it wasn't originally Austin, because I've got the deeds that passed that down too, and it looked as though it was whatever their grandmother's name was, Austin. Probably her father gave them, the Austins, a lot of land as maybe a dowry. They didn't give them Duck Lake, but they gave them all the rest of it that was over there. And that's how that all got started.
What type of wood was on this land that they wanted so badly?
I don't really know. I assume the same things that are here now, maple and oak and
birch,
and birch, is pretty nearly gone. There isn't a whole lot of birch left.
Not even a birch brook?
No. We've got about four of them out here that are maybe about 90 years old, but they're not long living trees either.
Do you have any idea how far the timber went back from the lake? What the depth was? Covered a great deal.
Oh, miles and miles and miles. I mean, this whole upper Michigan was covered with timber. And the reason they used it, they had all these rivers coming down, so they could cut from the river and dump it into the river, and it flowed down to the lake, so every one of these lakes had sawmills at the top of them.
Okay,
but it only lasted 15 or 20 years, and it was pretty much gone.
And something I never knew what you mentioned was that there were probably then no farms here until that timber was cleared.
No, you had small patches that the Indians had and that kind of thing, but there wasn't much in here.
Speaking of the Indians, do you have any recollection, not recollection, but do you have any idea what tribes were around here or where they lived? Any tales you've heard?
All I've heard is what I read, and you hear the same. It's interesting because I've tried to do some work down at the Muskegon Historical Society and gotten into their files, and you hear the same story every 10 years. It appears in some publication or some newspaper, and it's basically always the same, and it goes back to the same stories about Wabanango camping on the land up here where Murray's Inn is. That they apparently did that every summer, move. Then you hear the massacre that occurred over on
Indian Point,
and that story is, you hear that story repeated time after time in various ways. And the Indian tribes, as throughout the whole country, not just here, one tribe would come in and wipe out the other one, and what was left would retreat, and gradually they'd come back into the area again. I guess the last, I don't know, that, and of course Duck Lake had the French outpost at Duck Lake was there as one of the very last ones, and it was finally run by the wife of one of the early French settlers, and she was driven out. I don't know of anything that's left over there, but that was one of the last areas. There was a sawmill on Duck Lake too.
French outposts.
And it was sure the French settlers, not settlers, the trappers that came down here, and that was one of the big places they stopped. There was a store in that area.
Would that be where that graveyard is on top of the Duck Lake Dunes, the cemetery?
I don't even know where that is, and I've heard lots of people talk about it, and I don't know where it is. But yes, that's involved with it. That was a little community there. Would have to have been involved.
Yeah.
I don't think that's not an Indian. I think that's a white graveyard.
Yeah, it there are a couple Indians.
And it's too bad somebody doesn't kind of dig up the story around Duck Lake.
That's a good point.
There's a newspaper article that I have of about 1910 where they tried to change the name of Duck Lake. They even got a law through, or at least proposed in Michigan, to change it from Duck Lake to Mishalinda Lake. And then it died, and it's Well, they said there's so many duck lakes around the state there at that time, and I think there was up ten lakes called Duck Lake.
Yeah, you know, I had a hard time with that a graveyard too, just by and by. But there's a cement walkway that does go up there, but it's buried for the most part.
Okay.
And as you're going toward Duck Lake, it'll be right on the right, probably.
All right. Is it up on the hill?
Yeah, it's on top of the hill. You can walk up to the top. And there is a marker there that tells about it. But I wonder, where did you get your Fillmore deed, a copy of that deed?
Jim Lindrup got it out of the archives in Muskegon County. He had somebody, he didn't get the original, he just had somebody make a photostat of it.
That's wild, because I had a copy of one signed by Fillmore, also a copy of it, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Type of thing. Yeah. What are some of the most notable characters that you can remember here at White Lake? Just somebody, people that impressed you, or just characters that were outstanding?
Well, the typical characters, some which are still living, but would have to be Sedoni.
Joe Sedoni.
Well, senior.
Senior,
I'm talking
right.
about senior. And all kinds of wild stories.
Can you tell us about him, some of the things?
I really can't tell you very much about it. All I remember is that he was dealing with something called black light, and as kids we used to kid about this black light that you couldn't see. And I don't really have a whole lot of story, but there are people around here who do. I never went over there. A lot of them did. Dowie, which was before my time, was also another real character.
Can you tell us a story about Dowie, or what you know about
him? Well, Dowie was like some of your clan people now. He had a group of Zionists, Zion being an outgrowth of
Mormon?
Yeah, the Mormon.
Yeah,
it'd be an outgrowth of the Mormon. When the Mormons were really murdered, I mean, they murdered Joseph Smith out of Illinois, and then Brigham Young, the thing split up, and Brigham Young took one faction, but there were other factions. One of who wound up here at Beaver Island and became Strang, the king on Beaver Island, which is another story. And I think that Dowie set up something very similar in Illinois, and he used to have this summer camp up here, and he would bring all of his followers, and they'd come up in the big steamship, and they'd dock up there, and they'd parade up to the top of the hill, and they wore white costumes, and it was a big summer outing.
Approximately the years of that? Do you have any idea?
I'm guessing that's 1905 to 10, something like that. Maybe it's a little later than that. Probably a little later than that.
Okay. And what did he used to do up there? Did he?
I never heard any stories that there was any wild goings on or anything. It was he built quite an establishment there, which is now owned by who? It's owned by Howmet, or maybe it's Howmet. Somebody owns most of that land. One of the corporations does. But it was a summer outing, and it was a prayer outing, and they'd have picnics and that kind of a thing. It was not not like the Jim Jones and those things, or this thing down here in Texas.
Thank God. Yeah. Thank God. Tell me about this King Strang.
Strang. That doesn't really have anything to do with down here, but he is, he was, and the only reason I know this is because we were just up in Beaver Island, and he's the story on Beaver Island. He claimed that when Joseph Smith was killed and the Mormons were looking for new leadership, that Smith had given him a letter, which he produced, that said that he was the one who was to take over. So he really held the northwestern group of, northeastern group of Mormons, and was looking for a place to set up shop. He went up into Wisconsin, got thrown out of them. The Mormons had a tough time because they were considered to be almost disciples of the devil in a lot of ways. And the U.S. government was really on him. So he went to Beaver Island, set up there. They chased most of the Indians that were out up there. And he became a king. And he said he was a deity and a king until he later was assassinated. They shot him and he died two or three days later. But by this time, the Mormon movement had really followed Brigham Young, although when the split up came, they were about equal. And then Brigham Young moved to Utah and Salt Lake City, and they developed from there, not really from Illinois.
From King's Green. Yeah. Do you have any idea how big his colony was up there?
It would only be from memory, but I would guess that he probably had 600-700 people.
Okay. Was he assassinated by his own?
Some of them thought that they might be agents of the U.S. government because the marshals kind of helped these two get off the island, and they never did. They never did convict them of anything.
Wow. Why did the U.S. government hate them so much?
I don't really know. I think they feared them as a movement, that they were setting up something outside of the government structure within the United States. You know, this was all fairly wild.
And they had several wives, territory, which is against the Christian.
Yeah, but the wife thing, I think the wife thing is way over, yeah, over discussed. That was a tenant, but it wasn't as big as we tend to think it was. And only some of them, they didn't all have more than one wife.
Okay. Do you have any memories here of the Prohibition, the years during Prohibition? Do you remember any stories your father had or your family?
I don't remember really anything on the Prohibition thing. I do remember Miss Mary Butterfield was the epitome of the Victorian lady. And she loved to give parties and had the large house that Jim Butterfield lives in now. And whenever she'd give a party, she, of course, as a Victorian lady, would never touch any liquor or have anything to do with it. So when she invited people, the men, including my father and my uncle-in-law, just it was clearly understood that they were supposed to bring and set up the bar, and they brought the liquor, and she, you know, acknowledged it was there, but never had anything really to do with it. And another thing about her, because yes, she was well-liked by everybody, and the kids particularly, she used to like to give ice cream parties, which was a favorite ice cream social of that time. And during World War II, there was sugar rationing, and nobody had any sugar, but Miss Mary was going to give a ice cream social anyway. And everybody realized that she didn't know that she didn't have sugar and so forth. So everybody brought their own sugar and never told her, and she never necessarily acknowledged it. So the party went on.
That's great. Sugar was, of course, rationed.
Yeah, it was rationed, and you just didn't use a lot of sugar in ice cream. But the world went on regardless of what was happening as far as she was concerned. But I don't know anybody who didn't think of her in a very nostalgic and positive way.
Yeah, I've even heard stories.
Yeah. And she was always Miss Mary to anybody.
Miss Mary. That's great. You mentioned the Second World War. Did you serve during the Second World War?
Yeah. Most everybody up here served somewhere or other.
What did you do?
I was in field artillery and served. I couldn't get into I don't even know whether I tried the Navy, because most people up here went into the Navy. But I had a slight history of tuberculosis, so I presumed I couldn't get into the Navy. And I went into ROTC at college, the Army, and was field artillery. Went to England and then into France. And I don't have any big war stories or anything, but we did.
No,
you know, we shot for the crossing of the Rhine River, and we overran some of the the not necessarily camps, but the, what are now the concentration camps and things like that that we did over. And so you saw a little bit of that. But
you personally saw some of the camps?
Yeah.
What did you see?
Well, I remembered specifically, which wasn't a camp, but it was a barn, and they had we had overrun some political, I don't know what kind of prisoners they were, I guess political prisoners, and they put about 400 into the barn and set fire to the barn. When we got there, maybe 2 hours after the barn was set fire, everybody was obviously killed, mm-hmm. died, and I just remember the smell of it for 3 or 4 days afterwards. Nobody in the battery talked about it for 3 or 4 days. I mean, everybody had seen it and so forth, but it was just a subject you didn't discuss.
It was so horrendous
yeah,
to you as
yeah,
a human being.
Yeah. Now you pick up the newspaper and stuff like that happens all the time, but at that time it was
pretty rare.
Yeah. You know.
What do you have to say to the people then, since you were there, who never saw the Holocaust or don't think it's real? Was it real?
Sure. I mean, sure it was real. I personally think it gets way, way overblown. I mean, the Holocaust, or what you refer to as the Holocaust, is generally considered now the persecution of the Jewish people. Well, it wasn't just the persecution of the Jewish people. It was the persecution of the Romanians and the Gypsies, even worse than the Jewish people. But it was a fact. It did take place. It was as bad as everybody thought it was. But it is an issue that has been co-opted by just one group.
Yeah.
And they suffered too, and they suffered as much as anybody. But there were a lot of others that suffered. One of the specific things about the Jewish people suffered because they were Jewish, period. I mean, there's no excuse for this. And the Polish people suffered because they happened to be there and their land was occupied and so forth, or whoever else, Lithuania or what. Yeah, all these things occurred. We've since been to a couple of the camps that are now sort of monuments. Auschwitz is the big one that they see. And yeah, it's a sobering experience because it did happen.
When you finally started to talk about the barn and the people in it, what did you talk about? It took 3 or 4 days to even talk about it.
I don't think anybody really talked about it. I mean, you'd all seen the same thing. You all had the same thing. There wasn't anything. You all knew how the others felt. There isn't. You know, most of the talking that people do, it's, I did this, or I saw this, and you didn't. Therefore, let me tell you about it.
Yeah.
See, that's what most discussions are about. But that wasn't the case.
How'd you get your TB? Was you a young child? You said you had a touch of TB.
I don't know. I'm not even sure I even had it, although I was in bed for 8 months. But, you know, it's just like...
Like
what you have. Who knows exactly how you got it or where it comes from or anything else. I have no idea. But I've had no residual from it at all.
How old were you when you were in bed for 8 months? Huh?
15, 16, something like that.
And you lived where at that time? In Grand Rapids still?
Well, no. We lived in Chicago, and I came up here that summer.
So your dad was with this law firm in Grand Rapids?
And that was my grandfather.
Oh, your grandfather.
My father was a banker over in Chicago.
Okay. What bank did he work at?
He was with Continental.
Okay. What position did he have at Continental?
He was vice president in charge of municipal bonds.
Then you went on to college and you went to Princeton, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Do you have any memories of the Depression here? Any way that you were affected, your family was affected, your friends were affected?
I have absolutely no memories of the Depression. I don't see any, you know, you're supposed to say that you did this or you did that, but that was in my, everybody's growing up periods, at least certainly around White Lake, they always remember from age 15 up to about age 19 or 20. And that's always the golden era in most people's lives, particularly up here.
Exactly.
And then they move away or so, and that was kind of the depression period for me. See, that was, I was born in 1920, so 15 would be 1935. And so you don't, you know, most of us that have been fortunate, and everybody up here has been fortunate, really, you don't, in that period, you only remember the things that were good about it.
And being that age, you wouldn't be affected that much?
And you weren't that affected, no. Yeah. You know, you went up, you did what everybody else does right now.
Yeah.
And, you know, it hasn't changed. You had the same picnics, and you had the same blanket parties, and you had the same fussing from parents that everybody has now.
Back in the Second World War, how many people up here were killed that you know of, or that would some are here do? Were there any casualties?
I don't know. Was Joe Runyon killed in that? I think Runyon.
Yeah,
I think Runyon was killed in it.
Yeah. F.G. Baldwin, Mr. Baldwin.
I don't remember anybody in there. Was Fiffy's husband killed in that?
Yeah. He was a pilot in the Italian campaign.
No, I had a roommate that was a flyer that was killed, but I didn't have a whole lot of people that were suffered in it.
That's good. Tell me something, speaking of notable people here, a name that always comes up with the Sedoni clan is Jack DeFraga. Do you remember Jack DeFraga?
Again, I don't have any stories on, but you know, everybody has stories on DeFraga and Runyon particularly, and of course Harry Pillinger, and I mean that was the whole same crowd together, but they were all a little older than I was, so that all I knew, you know, I only knew kind of secondhand on most of the thing. But DeFraga was a good friend and stayed with the Sedonis.
So that was the wild crowd. Runyon, Pillinger, and DeFraga were the...
Yeah, and they'd probably be wild in most any sect. You know, they weren't.
But certainly it was a good type wild, I'm sure.
That's right. That's right. No, that's true.
Malicious, damaging type.
No, that's true.
Certainly, I guess some of us can be called that way.
Yeah.
Better be nice to the history, you know, to history here. Do you notice any change nowadays to the social aspects of White Lake? Are there more parties than there used to be? Is there more of an officious, sophisticated type of social realm here? In short, has it, you know, the people came up here for magic, and then the next thing you know, the lawns are all being fixed up and everything are getting fancier. Have you noticed anything in the social?
Well, I do in our group, I do, and we all tend to fuss about it. It tends to be of, well, we gave a party and we went to a party and we've been to their house three times, now we have to have them to our house and so forth. And that goes on a lot.
Yeah.
It didn't used to be that way because there weren't that many people. The entertainment was, there were a lot of beach picnics that were given, which were much more elaborate than anybody gives today. When you give a beach picnic, you might have 30 people, and you would have 8 or 10 or 12 folding tables on the beach with tablecloths, and you'd have silverware and china and everything else, and you'd put on a full, big meal with all kinds of things. And you don't see that anymore.
Not at all.
So you have four or five people will go down, or two or three families maybe will go down, and you buy the fried chicken, or you fix hot dogs or something like that. But I'm talking about they moved in, and it wasn't done by some caterer as it would be done today. If you did it today, you'd have a caterer do it. But everybody had servants and maids and people to do all these things, and they put on big parties on the beach.
Yeah. Big tables.
Big tables.
China,
yeah. Oh yeah, the whole bit. Sure, sure. And you don't see that here.
No, I've never seen.
You you see more of the, you know, the cocktail party type thing. I don't remember a lot of cocktail party things.
Yeah, that wasn't really part of what.
But now that's what you. That's the way people entertain. And if it's an upscale party, why, that means it includes food and a full meal, and it's maybe got some music to it of some kind.
You're talking about the maid and the servants. Do you remember any stories about the maids, or do you remember any of the maids or servants that were outstanding, that were somebody you would remember?
People brought their maids up with them from wherever they were, or maybe they brought a younger couple of kids. Stewart, what's her name?
Louise Stewart
did this until just recently. She'd always have a couple of young kids that would come up there and stay. And you must remember this.
Yeah, remember.
And she would really teach them how to entertain and how to cook and how to be. I mean, that she taught them finishing school, if you will.
To be proper, yeah.
And that went on, a lot of that went on. You brought people up and you taught them a trade, so to speak, because it wasn't.
So it was almost part of it was a social consciousness.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, and you were
taking care of the lesser.
But then there was the problem of how these people were going to have a social life of their own on Thursday night or whenever it was. And that was always the problem if you brought any blacks up. You had to make sure that there were some other blacks up here that they could socialize with, because otherwise they had a tough time.
Yeah.
So you had to look here. Kelly Sellers did on the same thing. And you have to remember what problems other people have, not just your own. Yeah, the social thing up here gets way out of hand.
Great. Is there the cocktail party? Was there more drinking back then?
Oh, I have one comment. We've got a friend down in Sarasota who was up here who loves parties. And she's just semi-well-liked, so she's always trying. She came up here and spent 1 week with us, and she, in all seriousness, said to Teasley, this is wonderful. She said, if you played your cards right, you could go to a party every night up here. And there may be some truth to it.
When do you get a chance to vacation?
Yeah.
And rest. Is there more drinking going on now than there would be when, let's say, your parents were having parties and things?
I don't think so.
Was there, at these beach affairs, would there be booze served there? Would there be drinking?
Yeah, but the women didn't drink that much. I don't, although they did drink, but yeah, there was drinking going on, sure. I mean, you know, it was bourbon was drunk and gin, vodka, I don't remember, vodka's brought in fairly recently. That was such a cheap drink, you know, until the Swedish got a hold of it, decided they could get $18 a bottle for it. But other than that, it's nothing but alcohol.
Yeah, just plain old
potato
booze.
Alcohol.
Back to the maids. Were there very many white servants, or were there just mainly black servants?
They were mostly white servants, as I remember. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Could you remember were there ever any racial problems or slurs with the blacks? Do you remember
that? I don't ever remember that as ever being an issue of any kind. The it's the only black family that was up, that was really here, was Brightwell, and they were well respected by everybody. You know, that isn't a plus or minus. If there's only one family, you don't have any problems necessarily. But they always were respected, and they did all the any shipping that you had to do, or any trucking from the railroads in, and all, they handled all of that for all the families up here, and they're as respected today.
Mm-hmm. Just as a personal insight, do you think we've gotten better with the racial problem, or have we just passed laws and haven't changed minds and hearts? Or
you mean nationally?
Just generally, yeah. Just your experience in life about it.
I don't know.
I think unquestionably the
black, if you're talking about black people, specifically on racial, because that's what people mostly say, and I think that you've given the black an economic chance much more than he had before. I don't know that you've given him all that much more social chance. However, That's my generation. And I think in my kids' generation, maybe the socially there is a great deal more acceptance. So I'm just talking about my generation.
Yeah.
I don't think there's been any more social acceptance. Yeah. Although, you know, we've had to put up with a lot in our growing up over, you know,
you people.
Well, you know, you got to go through all the social, the sexual mores we've had to go through, and the black and white, you know, it's hadn't been easy.
No. What do you think about the sexual change in this country? Or has there been a change? Was there, I mean, when you were young, were you sexually active without being any particular?
Yeah, but, you know, you didn't talk about it nearly, obviously you didn't talk about it as openly as they do now. And the openness is kind of too bad, because part of the interest or the intrigue of sex is the secretiveness of it, and part of it is, you know, gee, I'm the one who discovered this thing, you know, and when you break that down, then it doesn't become as intriguing or as interesting or as personal or anything else. It's just a bodily function, which is kind of too bad.
Yeah, I think it's a very good point.
I mean, okay, so it is a bodily function, but it's always had a lot greater intrigue to it than that.
Yeah, the mystery, the ore.
Yeah, and it's part of the fun of it.
How do you feel on a social scale, or just socially speaking, how do you feel America has advanced, or have we advanced as a nation of people? I guess, are we improving, do you think, as a nation, or are we going backwards?
Well, I have no question about what we've improved, and, you know, in my lifetime, when you go overseas, the American is always, I don't care where you went, as an individual, and as even a government, you were looked upon with favor, you were accepted in almost any place, any societies you ever went into, and they envied you. Now, obviously, we had son of a bitches too, but generally speaking, the American was considered to be a naive, enthusiastic, honest, open, but not very devious person. And I think as we've grown up, we've lost a lot of that. But
that's a very good point. I think you're right.
We've lost it. We've become, and maybe that's inevitable when you get on top. We weren't on top. But now we begin to tell everybody what to do. And I don't care who it is. I mean, we don't have any business going into some of these countries and saying that you've got to do it because that's the way we've evolved. And we do that. Mm-hmm. We do it every time you pick up the paper.
Or Latin American, I mean, just all the things we've done since we've become powerful, or, yeah.
One of the things I think would be kind of fun, you know, the Germans have developed this, what is it, the abortion pill, RDU?
The Germans
are the ones that developed that.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they're the, Hecht is the company that did it. Then they market it through France, and that's where you hear most of the stuff, but it was the Germans that did it. Or, let's say, the French, didn't make any difference. And we're saying, you know, you got to give us this. And then we get politically, Bush says, we don't want it. And then Clinton says, yeah, we want it. But after all, it isn't ours. It belongs to them. And I think it'd be kind of fun if the Germans said, well, now, wait a minute. We're just not going to give it to you. I don't care whether you want it or not until you clean up your act in Miami and in Detroit and Chicago, and our tourists get over there and get killed. You give us a report once a year on what you're doing, and then we'll decide whether we're going to give it to her or not. You know.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. We have become bad boys.
Yeah, we're doing it. We're doing it to others.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're not supposed to get into all this politics.
This is great. You're fascinating. That's what I want. No. Right? We're going to save this. Your grandkids will be able to look at it. Your great grandkids, I hope. Just a real quick aside on this. I just personal experience a couple of years ago, or back in 1985, I met someone. She'd been in a camp during the Second World War. She was Jewish. She'd been in the camp for 5 years. She was a Pole. And I asked her what she thought about the Americans, Germans, and Russians. And she said to me that the Russians were absolutely brutal. The Germans were cruel,
yeah.
but the Americans were naive, which is what you said, which was our duty, I think. Yeah. We were enthusiastic.
That's why they left,
We've lost that, I'm afraid. Yeah. But that's neat that you said that, because that's what she said.
And I think that's what most foreign people expected. I mean, that's the way most foreign people looked at it.
The turn of the century idealism and, yes. Okay, back to Sylvan Beach and White Lake. What was the biggest wedding that you remember here, the wedding that was outstanding, just any that you can remember?
I've got to draw a blank on that. I don't remember anything particularly.
What was the, we're back to not notable but now, but famous people that came to White Lake. Do you recall any famous people here?
Oh, was it Perot came up here?
Ross Perot was here last year.
Last year.
Yeah. Or for 2 years, our first big find.
And Mel Gus, all of them are fairly recent. I remember when Eli Schmidt from Milwaukee, Schlitz Beer. He used to come in here in that big yacht.
Yeah, yeah.
And your dad, or your grandfather, really, I think, is the one who knew him as much as anybody.
Now, didn't he used to bring, I heard as a kid that he used to bring beer over during the Second World War for the yacht club. He'd bring over Schlitz beer.
Yeah, he'd bring Schlitz beer. And so for a long time, they had Schlitz beer until your father came along and he peddled this stuff from St. Louis.
Well, he had stock.
I knew there must be something like that.
But I do remember because they only sold Schlitz when I was younger.
Yeah. They, not necessarily, but the way everybody used to get up here, you're talking about Sylvan Beach and all, and of course most people in Sylvan Beach know all of this, but like my father, for example, a banker in Chicago, would get Friday night on the ship. From the Carolina was the main one that was in. It was the Goodrich Line. And they would arrive early Saturday morning at the Sylvan Beach Arcade, which of course now is all gone, but not the arcade so much as the dock was there. And then they'd unload there. Oh, yeah. And everybody would come down and meet the boat. And then the boat would make a couple of stops around the lake, including for a while at what was called Michelinda, which is now Lakeside, and then go down to Whitehall and spend the weekend in Whitehall. And then Saturday night, it would come by at about 8 or 9 o'clock, would make the reverse, pick everybody up, take them back to Chicago, and they got in there Monday morning.
Okay, it'd be Sunday night.
Sunday night. And then they'd get in there early Monday morning. And that's the way people went back and forth. Later the train, it went to Holland, then it went to Grand Rapids, and Muskegon used to even come up here. But then it was gradually cut back. I guess it only goes to Holland now.
Do you remember anything about the boat in particular, or those days of meeting your father? Do you have any particular memories of that smell?
Well, I think, yeah, I remember. I mean, everybody used to be down on the docks, and the arcade was the long dock, and then stores on either side, and then an arch across connecting the two stores. So you went underneath that arch to go out to the end of the dock. That's right where the swimming area is right now, and you can still see parts of it. And there was the post office was there, and the store was there, and Leonard and Edna ran the store. Our Leonard ran the store, and Edna was the postmistress over there. But that was, you talk about social life, you see, that was part of the social life began. It was a hectic 2 days, and then most of the men went on back.
Well, that must have been a hectic 2 days.
So it was a hectic 2 days, and they were here, and then they went on back. And some of them would sleep on the boat going either way. Some of them, I guess, would sit up and drink and play cards, too. But.
And so early in the morning, you'd get up with your mom, and would you drive a boat down there? Would you drive a car down there?
Yeah, you'd drive. We had cars. Didn't go by boat. We had cars.
Okay.
but that's the way they got back and forth, and so the women were up here mostly without their men. There's so many retired people up here. I don't remember retired people up here at that time.
It was pretty barren for that, I would imagine.
Yeah,
it wasn't comfortable.
Yeah. But I came up here, my grandmother, really, I came up here with my grandmother, took all her grandchildren for all summer. And we would, and my cousin and I would stayed in the boathouse here, and the Frenches were on here, and the Hanchets were up in the house over here. That's Joe Hanchett and Alice, and Alice Ann, and Wheezy. But Joe's the only one that's still up here.
Who was your cousin?
Denny Dennison.
Oh, that's
he died. He was killed in an automobile accident.
He was leaving and from here, wasn't he? Didn't he have just left White Lake?
Yeah, he had left White Lake. I mean, a lot of people thought we were brothers up here because we were always. A lot of people thought that.
Yeah. He was a very kind man. I remember that. He was always very nice to me. And just very gracious. That's too bad. So you lived down in the boathouse.
We lived in the boathouse.
Well, that must have been a great time for two young
people. Yeah, that's where we. There's no running water down there, either running in or running out. But
she was the girl who came with the place.
Yeah,
the Indian princess.
Right,
running water.
Right.
Can you tell me who were your peers when you were growing up up here?
Well, strangely, in sailing, the two peers that I knew were both women, girls. One was Polly Frank, and the other would be Barbara Spears at Sylvan, and both of them were excellent sailors. And I don't know, sailing, they kind of looked up to them as much as anybody else. Because the boats on the lake, there were some sea boats, there were some gaff rig sea boats on the lake, but the A boat was the main big boat that was sailed here. And there was, I don't know, there were probably seven or eight of them on the lake. Phantom and the Taggarts and then the sea was a gaff rig at that time, and then the Marconi rig came in, and I think Jim Butter, either Mac Butterfield or Ralph Taggart had the first Marconi seas, and they beat the gaffs, so the gaffs went out right away. But nobody ever pulled the boats out of the water like they do now on lifts. You anchored them on buoys.
Yeah, which when I was a child.
Yeah. So you usually had to go out and bail them out before you could sail them in.
The storm, too, you were always down there.
Yeah, they're always turning. Yeah.
It makes you love sailing sometimes. Yeah. Oh, jeez. We were in the junior yacht club, I would imagine, right? Who were the people that were prominent there? The Commodores, the people you remember?
Well, the same names that you have around here, you know, right now. Practically everybody was at some time involved in it, but Neil and Jimmy Butterfield and Ralph Taggart and Mac Butterfield. And all those were all up and down this shore. And Bill Hartz was a year or two older than I was, so a year or two, you know, put him way up in someplace else. McDonald, Middleton. And they're all names that are still around.
Yeah.
I regret we can't get Ralph Taggart to come back here. I've tried to get. I don't know. I've talked with him a couple of times. He lives in the east, up in Maine now. But for some reason, he doesn't want to come back. He thinks nobody will know him.
Well, if he waits long enough, that might be true. Did you used to have your meetings on Thursday night, the junior yacht club?
I don't remember.
Did you sail at night? Did you have the moonlight sail?
Yeah, you had a lot of that kind of stuff, which they don't do. And you had, you always had some sort of function, treasure hunts and beach parties, and a lot of it was away from the yacht club. I mean, not necessarily in the yacht club like it is now. I don't remember the dance that you had. I remember with my kids always having the, what was it, Wednesday night or Thursday night
Thursday
dance?
Night.
Thursday night dance.
And Wednesday night square dance.
Yeah, there was a dance, and there was a square dance. And but I don't remember that when I was young that we did that so much.
When you were younger, what did you use for transportation? Let's say if you were going to go over to San Juan Bay and have a beach party or go to Lake Michigan here. What did you do to get there? Did you have small power boats like we did when we were growing up, or did you walk?
I don't remember the power boats so much. You know, you had rowboats and canoes, and you walked, and car, and automobile, you know.
But you probably used your boats more than
I used the boats, I think, more. It seems to me you were in the boat more. Well, the boats up here used a lot of times just for racing.
Yeah.
And we used them a lot more than that.
You know,
most everybody had a canoe or a rowboat.
Yeah.
And you got around that way. Not so much the outboard.
This is a question, because do you notice, for instance, with the sailors and the yacht club and sailing and things like that, has it become more competitive? Has it become more scientific and more refined? Is it nearing an obsession or sport? Or what do you think? What are your views?
I mean, it's like any of these sports; they've become much more scientifically. I mean, golf, for example. You know, you take a stick and hit a ball. Now they have the greatest invention of the century because they've increased the size of the club head, you know, by an eighth of an inch or something. But in the same way, and sailboats probably even more so. Now, most of us, you learned how to sail rather than how to make the boat go that much faster. And equipment was not nearly as good, well designed, well thought out, or anything else.
And you would use your sailboat more than to as transportation and not be as concerned about messing some fine tuning up on the boat. Because I can remember that even in my childhood, watching the change from kind of a fun sport.
Yeah, now a lot of them will use, they don't want anybody on their boat, or they don't want anybody except to race. You see?
Yeah, that's too bad.
Yeah.
When we were young, did you have the skipper's regattas where the first place captain of the boat would race the last place boat, and the last place fellow would race the first place boat?
I remember doing that a couple of times, but not too often. People used to like a variety of racing, kind of racing, and that it might be that kind of a thing. It's not necessarily involving skill, and they used to like that. And they used to like to sail at the yacht club, because you don't get a crowd at the yacht club to watch the races anymore. But now, racing, all they want is the same course, and they want to make sure there are three beats in it, and there's one or two runs, and maybe an off leg. And if you give them anything different, they don't like it. In other words, you can't. We used to sail a race that was around the lake, and you go from one buoy to one other.
To Harvey's Red Stake.
And up to Harvey's Red Stake and back. Well, nobody likes that anymore. They don't consider that a challenge.
Yeah, I can remember
I know if I were to try giving somebody a running start, I've always kind of thought maybe I'll do that, because I don't think anybody knows how to do that anymore. They wouldn't like that.
Yeah.
It isn't a test of the skill. They don't like it. Sure it is, but... And some of that's kind of too bad, but...
Yeah, well, it is too bad, I think. Yeah. I guess part of what occurred too was we don't have the dock starts anymore, so the crowds probably left.
Yeah, that's it.
I used to love the dock starts, and many times I remember we would start on a run. That's the way the wind was.
If you have a dock start, you can't start into the wind all the time. And here, everybody's very particular about being exactly into the wind.
Yeah.
Or at least 5 degrees favoring the port end or something like that.
Yeah, kind of, I remember when the skipper's regattas were stopped when I was young, it was kind of like it was sailing wasn't fun anymore. Everybody became into it for themselves.
Yeah.
It became real competition, and not sportsmanship, and that's a shame. That's a shame. Speaking of sailing, you yourself were a sailing school instructor, weren't you?
Yeah.
Can you tell me what years you were teaching?
I don't remember.
You don't remember yet.
Must have been 38, 9, 40, something like that.
And then later on, do you remember any of the students you had? Do you remember any that any in particular?
I don't remember any of the students.
Okay.
Of course, you know, that was just that's beginning of the war years now, and you're beginning to think about a lot of other things. And
did you see the war coming when you were that age? Did you see it coming? Did you know it was coming?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You were very. Although it didn't affect you necessarily in 1940, 41. Well, by 41 certainly, but 1938, 39, 40. Yeah, you knew what was going on. I mean, you were highly cognizant of the reasons and the political business, and of course, everybody wasn't necessarily anti-German in this country either. At that time, there were a lot of them that thought that the Germans were right. So, I mean, you don't hear very much about that now, but at that time, Lindbergh, of course, is the one that comes to mind, but there are many others.
Now, he even feared the German Air Force, and he thought it was unbeatable.
Yeah, yeah. Darn near what was for a while.
Wow, yeah, we were fortunate to have some breaks there. Well, later on, you were to become the sailing school chief. You were in charge of the whole show. I remember I worked for you for three, 4 years there. Do you remember what years those were when you were the sailing school supervisor? Do you remember?
No.
Because I was teaching. 60,
when were you? 70?
No, 66, 67. 66, 67. Around in there.
Well, it would have to be about, it'd have to be about 65. What it was that Neil had it.
Yeah, Neil had it my first year.
Had it, and then he, for one reason, I don't know what it was, he couldn't do it. So I took it over and had it for about 4 or 5 years. And tried to, we'd worked off Youngquist's teachings for so long. First of all, you worked off Guerin's and Pillinger's, and then Youngquist came along and he changed it. And by the time I got in there, why, everything the youngest had done was great, but it was kind of passe.
Yeah.
So we tried to go to a printed textbook at that time.
That's
which
right.
We used
for
a long time.
You were the first one to bring out a textbook, and, I remember that.
It was a textbook. And so I frankly tried to get away from Youngquist without telling everybody, because of course he was considered kind of a semi-god up here. Although he also got into a lot of jurisdictional problems with various people. He was not all that well-liked by some, anyway.
Hmm. Yeah, did you like him yourself first?
Yeah, I liked him very much. But I was a kid, he was.
Yeah. Who was the best sailor you can remember at White Lake? Female and male, which were the best sailors that you can remember during your whole life? Which are the ones that would come to your mind if you were,
Probably Barbara Speer would be the best female sailor. But of course, as far as best sailing and racing people, the ones today are just head and shoulders over, anybody else. Chad Gould probably is the best up here. He's not really necessarily up here, but I think if you had to put some money on any one of them, that would probably be Chad.
Okay. Well, during your...
But there are a lot of, there are a lot of good sailors up here now.
During your years, your younger years, your 20s, your 30s, your teenage years?
Well, it was whoever had the newest boat.
Yeah, that's
that had a lot to do with it.
Yeah, new sail.
A lot, yeah.
Whoever new cotton had, sail.
Whoever had,
the, out yet.
Whoever had the thing. But,
that's a really good point.
I'm trying to think of who was. Of course, the Spring Lakes sailors always seem to beat the White Lake sailors in my time. Spring Lake always had the best sailor, and they still have good sailors.
Who were some of those?
Well, Jacobson and Reichert and Welch.
Eggerts also.
Eggerts came along a little later, but yeah, the Eggerts would be one.
So Reichert's was a real sailor.
Reichert was good, Reichert, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
They had the store, didn't they?
Reichert had the store, yeah.
And then they opened that up here. I think Cade worked in there once.
Right, right.
Speaking of Cade, can you tell us your children, the name of your kids, and what they're doing and where?
Can I tell you the name of my kids?
Yes.
Let me think. Well, you start Cade as the oldest, and as you know her better than any of the others. But and since we're on this thing, and I don't have a chance to tell them directly, actually, we've got three kids, and each one have become extremely proficient and extremely well qualified, and in their own particular fields. And of course, and yet they are all, each individually, very hard to live with, as all of us are in their family, because we tend to want to be bossy, and so that part's maybe on the detriment. But Cade, of course, is extremely successful in her profession.
Which is what?
And which is a financial advisor. And when you suddenly, as a father, and whose father had been in the banking business, you realize that your daughter knows infinitely more than you do about finances or anything else, that's kind of sobering, you see. But it's true. It's true.
Uh-huh. And she's very successful.
Yeah.
Very successful.
And the next one is John, is equally as successful in the field that he is in forestry. And he's a district forester in the state of Colorado, and he has maybe, I don't know whether it's 20%, but 15 to 20% of the state under his control, forestry control. And that includes management of the forest lands, as well as private timber lands, and of course fire control and so forth. But he's lives a lot of outdoor life, and he lives in Grand Junction, and highly qualified, and he's the one that tells me which mushroom I can eat and which I can't. So that's so,
you know,
so he's paying back his. And then the last one is David, who came along about 9 or 10 years later. And David has had probably more experiences than the rest of them, in that he went to Berkeley and then went to Japan and lived in Japan for 6 years, and was in the insurance business and also in the financial business in Japan. Speaks Japanese extremely well, and happens to be feel that his mission is to try to teach the American business people how to win over the Japanese. He thinks it's just terrible the way the Japanese have walked all over.
I know, your son business just loves that.
Yeah, too. And but David is even more vehement about that. He thinks that we got to do something about it.
How does he feel about the recession the Japanese are into now?
I don't know. That's fairly recent. I haven't talked to him very much, but I'm sure he'll say, just because they're in a recession, look out. That doesn't mean they're down or anything else. And of course, he married a Japanese girl and has moved. Now they have just moved back to the United States, so he's had the problem of getting started in business again in the United States. And everybody asks why he didn't go to work for a Japanese company in the U.S., but it was just for that reason. He said, I don't want to help a Japanese company.
That's great.
So they've all done, you know, they're very...
all successful in their own fields,
yeah,
at the very top.
Yeah, and I borrow money from them now. They don't come to me.
Don't tell my father.
Rates are not so good. Rates are not so good. But
usury, huh?
Yeah.
You have a map as I walk in the door here, and there are 10 million pinholes in it, and pins from where you've been around the world. Can you tell us what you did or do, and why you traveled so extensively?
Because I like to, I guess.
And you've lived everywhere, too. I mean, you've lived in Jordan, you've lived... You can't name them all. What exactly was your line of work that allowed you to move around the world as you've done?
Well, it probably, you know, as with many people, got started through the courtesy of the United States government when they decided to send you to England and France. And during, you know, we got this war started so we could travel. That's how things started.
That's what Boy Scout.
And I got discharged in France, and Teasley and I had been married just before I went over, so she came over there and joined me there. So that's kind of the way the two of us got started on the thing, I think. And
year was that?
That was 1944. And I guess 45 mostly. And we lived in Paris for about, I think we lived there about 7 months, and by that time she was 7 months pregnant, so we decided we had to come home.
Were you discharged?
I had been discharged in Europe, okay. and went to work for the State Department. And since I'd failed in college, I'd failed French, and I'd also failed statistics, where obviously they put me in charge of a statistics department in Paris. So that was the first job that we had.
What did you keep track of? What were the statistics that you would...
Well, you know what a genius I am. I had an IBM department, believe it or not. I was head of a section of IBM department. But IBM at that time was a set of punch cards, a machine that punched the holes in the cards, and a sorter, and a printer. I mean, it wasn't a computer. It was just punch card stuff. But, anybody can learn how to do that kind of stuff.
What did you do for the State Department, though? I mean, did this continue on?
We were just, all we were doing was trying to assemble all the surplus property. See, the war's over and they've got all this stuff over there. And they're trying to get rid of it. They're either trying to give it away or sell it. And a lot of it went to the displaced camps for displaced persons. It went to some of the countries that needed it. But, you know, they aren't going to bring all that stuff back. The munitions they got rid of, they just blew them up. But there was a lot of jeeps and trucks and foodstuffs and clothing and that kind of stuff. And
so
most of it, this is all the part of the Marshall Plan, where you were trying to rebuild what you destroyed.
Was Europe as devastated after the Second World War as I've read? It seems like it was in chaos.
Mostly you had peoples moving all over, much more so than now. I mean, displaced people from the Russian lines and the German and the French, all this in Europe. And you still didn't have any real peace with Russia, although we were our allies. As soon as the war was over, the fight for territory broke out among all.
What was wrong in that? Were they justifiably paranoid of us, or what was the they took over everything Nazis had taken over?
Well, I don't know that anybody was wrong. They wanted it all, and we wanted it all. I mean, what's different? That's what happens today, you know.
Exactly.
You know. They wanted as much as they could have, and we kept saying they ought to give it up, and they didn't want to give it up. You know, we gave it back there because we wanted to come back to this country, most of our people. But we're sort of unique in that way. You know, when the Germans move into France, they don't automatically give France up. When the Israelis move into Palestine, they don't give Palestine back to them. So
that's right, that it was a wonderful American
dream. So it hasn't changed.
Yeah.
But we don't want anything in Europe, really. We'd like to control it. But we don't want it.
We don't want to seize territory.
But these other people want the territory. Yeah. Now, we may want to control it. We don't want them doing things that we don't like, but other than that.
It does go against the American ilk, the American psyche.
Well, we've got enough here to handle it.
Yes.
We've got enough problems here. But then, in business. I travel in business and so forth.
But when did you leave working for the State Department?
I came right back here and worked for a hospital supply company, and then we moved around, as everybody did at that time.
What are some of the countries that you moved to?
Well, I didn't move to any countries at that time. The only countries we've really lived in are, Japan is the only one where we, business-wise, we lived in.
But yeah, you were there for a long time.
We were there for a couple of years. That's how David got interested in it.
But you traveled extensively in the hospital supply business.
And we traveled in the hospital supply business because I was in the international field. We traveled into the Middle East and traveled into South America, and you know, wherever the money is where you went.
What did you like the best? What place did you like being in the best? What sphere, nation?
Well, if you decide what countries you would like to visit and you don't know any countries, go where the British first conquered. Singapore, Kenya, South Africa, Hong Kong, you know, they wound up with the best places in almost any place that you go.
Did you really think that the British rule did a good job? Were you impressed by what they had left?
Yeah, I think so. I know it's a favorite. The political correctness is that you're supposed to say that they rule and then they didn't leave any one thing when they pulled out. But the areas that they were in are still, I mean, you go into Africa, and the best areas in Africa even today are Kenya, South Africa, I mean, economically and everything else, Egypt, and the British were in Egypt a long time. And you go into the Far East and, you know, Singapore and Hong Kong, those were still the big areas, and they don't control them anymore. So yeah, on balance, I think they did a good job.
Yeah, I would say so too.
But they picked the cream of it. I mean, they cherry-picked what they did.
And they ruled the seas for several hundred years, so it was
they
had the option.
Yeah.
That's great. How did you meet Teasley, by the way?
In church, you know, where else? Actually, we did meet in church. We left at some a youth group in a church in Evanston.
Okay.
And
fell in love.
Yeah, so then, you know, you don't know what you're doing at that time anyway, so. So then we actually got married in a church, you know.
At the same church?
Yeah.
That's neat.
No, didn't get married in the same church. We got married in St. Louis.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, Jefferson Barracks.
Oh, you're kidding?
Yeah. I was a 24-hour-old second lieutenant, and her father was a public relations officer at Jefferson Barracks. So when, as a new second lieutenant, when I arrived on the post, they gave me, I don't know, a 16-gun salute or something, which is what they give that person. It wasn't a 21-gun salute.
That must have been.
I guess there isn't any Jefferson Barracks anymore, is there? Probably.
It's still
not.
There.
Is it?
The cemetery is still there. And I imagine, I think that flood may have nailed it because that was right on the south side of St. Louis.
Well, it was a big Air Force processing center at that time.
Huh.
And they processed and sent them overseas from there.
Huh. Yeah. General Grant served there, or Lee served
there. Yeah, it's an old.
Yeah, very old, barracks. Back to White Lake. The lake is going up and down. Do you have any memories of the lake doing as much as it's done in the last 20 years? Is this part of any sort of trend you see, or cycles, the lake going up and down here? Do you remember this type of fluctuation in your early years?
Well, as long as I can remember, people have talked about cycles, and they talk about a 7-year cycle, and they talk about a 3-year cycle imposed upon a 7-year cycle imposed upon a 21-year cycle, and about that time you begin to realize they don't know what they're talking about. But they claim cycles. There are charts and records kept from, I don't know, about 1870. And when I was sick in bed and they were trying to get things to entertain me, that was one of the things that I did. I got all these back charts and tracked this stuff through. And I don't think there's any pattern that I can think of. I think I remember the lake being considerably lower than it was this past low period, because I remember we used to be able to walk from here to the yacht club without getting our feet wet. Now it may have been lower and they just worn the bank down in the high weather, but yeah, we've had this up and down cycle. As far as I'm concerned, the lake right now is cleaner than it has been in a long, long time, whatever clean means. Used to have reeds all along here, and I mean,
like a wetland type thing.
Yeah, a wetland type thing. You'd go through and there in a canoe, and you could almost be hidden in a canoe, hide yourself in there. And all of that's gone. And
what caused that to go away?
I don't know. I really don't know.
Pesticides?
That may be a, I don't know whether it's pesticides, but it may be a change in the whatever nutrients in the land. It may be just washing off your fertilizer that you put on the grass and so forth. I don't know. But then you had a weed problem. We had a serious weed problem, and you probably remember some of that, where it would grow on the surface. By August, it would be on the surface up here, and when you sailed, you're continually, you could go into a weed thing and get stopped dead.
Yeah, I remember. We used to have weird machines at the yacht club.
And you had machines, and you had chemicals, and you had, I know I had rakes, and I had a big sai, a regular sai for the, you know, for wheat.
Oh, okay.
And we'd go out there and cut the reeds and the weeds. And, you know, they always claimed that it was hooker, it was something else. Well, maybe they had something to do with it, but it certainly isn't all that. And then, of course, the tannery got blamed. And you hear stories about people picking up carcasses or something from the tannery. And I don't know whether those ever happened. But the lake level changes, that's all.
Yeah, but you see no pattern?
I don't see any pattern. I'm not a fisherman, but we used to get pickerel and northern pike and that kind of thing in here. I don't think they get any of that anymore.
Do you remember the Sylvan Beach Hotel at all? Do you have any memories of
it? Not very much. I remember where it was, and I think I remember it burning, but I'm not, you know, it's a vague memory.
Do you remember any fires up here? Anything that you ever saw destroyed?
The only fire that I remember was in our own plant here. We have a lot of walnut trees, black walnut trees that my grandfather planted. And they used to go out with these burning rags and kerosene and burn the tent caterpillars that were on it. And one year they caught fire and it burned the whole back lot, but the fire department from either Whitehall or Montague came just about the time they got it out before it never got to the house. But fire has always been a, I don't know why we haven't had more fires than we have had, frankly. It's been very surprising to me.
Yeah, it is.
Because you don't have, you know, a way to get them out.
Yeah. When you get concerned with the amount of things you do crazy when you're young.
You start something at Sylvan on those hills. Well, when the WAB burned down, why didn't that take Kelly's place, Sellers, and all of that? You know, it's really luck more than anything else.
Yeah, the grace of God and luck and everything.
Yeah, and how? Why didn't your house go down?
Yeah.
You know, it's
yeah,
right,
why didn't
right
that
next
whole road?
Sure.
Yeah, because they are classic old places that
sure.
all wood and
sure.
dried
sure.
and old and
sure.
everything else. Do you remember at all the ferry that used to go across the channel?
Yeah, I think most anybody of that era remembers that
mm-hmm.
because it was unique and you went across. It carried, I think, two cars, I think you could have on it. And the cable is probably still down underneath it. I would, that's because they just dropped the ferry. I mean, they just dropped the cable down. They didn't take it out. And you can still see very clearly where the two landings are on either side.
Okay, yeah. What did it cost to ferry a car across? And could you be a passenger? Like if you were
yeah, you could go as a passenger. I've forgotten. 50 cents or something for a car.
Okay.
I don't recall. I don't recall.
Well, how long did that last, and why did it stop? Do you think?
Well, it stopped because they didn't get any business. See, there weren't very many people on the other side of the lake. Certainly not up in here.
Yeah.
Which is kind of strange when you have to remember that the first large community on this area, maybe except for Whitehall, was at the mouth of the channel, which is where Old Channel Inn is. I mean, there were what? There were 10, 12 buildings there. And that was where all the lumber ships came. They came up to that and anchored offshore, and then they brought the small ships, would come out the what's now the Old Channel, and take the lumber to those ships. So the community was right there, and that was the Indian area. That was all developed over there. And so you have that cemetery up there, you know. But that all that then left. It was all gone. It's only now coming back as houses and cottages.
How far did the Old Channel go up before it went into Lake Michigan?
It went in right there.
Right there at the Old Channel.
Where the Old Channel is, yeah. Okay. And if you go up there, it's kind of hard to see that could have been deep enough to bring some, you know, reasonably good-sized ships in. Not ships, but
barges
and stuff like that. It's where the parking area is, or where you go through, the cut through the dune to go to the beach, right by the Old Channel Inn. It'd be just south of Old Channel Inn.
Okay.
You know, it's a lowland. That's
right.
Got to be where, I mean, I don't remember it, but that's got to be where it was.
Was that naturally filled in, do you think?
Or
was
sure,
that, was
sure.
Filled in?
Sure.
Was that naturally there before we civilized this area? Sure.
That was the outlet for the lake. I mean, the river fed lake, and when they dug when the lumber industry talked them into digging the channel, which they did, I mean, that's how it got dug, and then they brought the boats in. Now you had the natural flow going out the channel, so it didn't have to wind up there, and it filled in.
All the pressure was released.
Sure, filled in.
Okay.
Yeah, that channel was put in because of the lumber industry.
So that would put the channel back in about 1880s?
80s, I think, 87, something like that, 80-something, yeah.
And that originally was built with a wooden walk on it?
I don't remember that.
Gee, I thought you remembered.
No, I don't remember that. But it must have had a wooden catwalk. The one at, where is it, Grand Haven? One of them still has a catwalk going out there, yeah.
Okay, what was the... back to the Old Channel, then the boats with the barges would pick up the wood from the different...
They'd float down the stream, they'd float down the river, and the logs would be down there, and they'd be most of the sawmills were at this end.
Okay.
So they'd been cut up into lumber, and they'd be loaded on barges, and they'd be brought up here, out there, and offloaded onto ships that would then take it into the Milwaukee-Chicago area. That's where most of them went.
Were there many disputes that you mentioned to your father, your grandfather, with the law firm, and that there was settlements made, how you got the land and things like that, with disputes? Was it with all these companies on the lake, how did they sort out the wood, and were there disputes among them on land and rights, and who settled these disputes? Did the government, federal government?
I don't really remember any of the disputes. As far as the logging, I don't know the logging business, but when you cut a log, you mark it some way. And when it comes down, it's channeled. There's a guy there that channels it to the various people who own the logs. So that's the logging thing. There had to have been arguments over land. Shoot, there's arguments today over land. And, you know, this business with DaCosta and the guy who built there, and whether they're going to build 4 feet over the property line and so forth. So there's still that. There was a dispute over the property line that's on my east end, because that property line was drawn from over here by the sand dunes, where there's a government marker, pull this way, and the other ones over there were done over here, and there was an overlap. So there was a period, there was a space of about 4 or 5 feet that was in dispute. And when I tried to get the thing surveyed, the surveyor wasn't Buck at that time, but the guy before Buck, wouldn't survey that line. So about 5 years ago, I went and I said, look, both of us know where the line is. Why don't we go down to the county and tell them, look, you get your record straight. We know where it is on the land. We're not arguing about it or anything else, and I don't know who's right or wrong technically, but there it is. Let's just draw it out, which we did.
We just agree on it and be done with it.
Yeah.
What was the worst storm you can remember here? Do you remember any in particular?
You know, the storms I remember are generally when you'd have a regatta here and one of these line squalls, or not maybe not the worst one, but a line squall would come through and you'd at 4, and they always come through at 4 a.m. to 4:30 a.m. in the morning, and you'd look out, because Denny and I were down in the boathouse here, and we'd looked out and here are 50 boats all turned over upside down, you know. So we'd get in the rowboats and everybody else would, and pull these things out. There was masts were stuck in the mud. But by, you know, 10 o'clock, most of these storms blow over, you'd get them all back up again.
Yeah.
But I don't really recall any very, very serious storms that blew a lot of things down. But, you know, we have them every year.
Yeah.
We've got some of the trees go down and somebody gets hit or somebody doesn't. But
do you remember, just a question, with the, I guess the sailboats you're talking about, they would always be out there on the marks and they would sink if a storm came out. I guess after a few years, the sailboats would be almost about the same. After 4 or 5 years, they'd all be waterlogged about the same amount. The new boats, as you said, would win, right? And then the old boats, I think, would be about the same as time went on, basically.
You got new sails. Anybody who could afford new sails every other year would do
it's
the
not
winning.
Like fiberglass, I guess.
It's not like fiberglass, and it isn't like Dacron sails.
Yeah.
I mean, you can the canvas sails, you know, if they had to be dried out because they didn't when you came in. And if you turned over, if the sails were wet, you left them up to dry.
Yeah.
You didn't just put them away. But the whole equipment was much less sophisticated than it is today. And the wood boat, the wood would swell. As a matter of fact, when you put it in, if it had been out all winter, it filled up rapidly with water. And you just left it there in a submerged condition for a day or so. Then you pumped it out, and by now the wood had swelled up and it didn't leak anymore.
Yeah.
And it had to do that, otherwise the boards would warp.
Oh, okay. So they, you know, yeah, that's
so you wanted it to do that when you first put it in, yeah.
Okay. Do you remember any particular Pirate's Ball, or did you get to stay here when you were going up for Pirate's Ball?
Yeah, I remember going to all of them, as the kids were always went. Sometimes they put you to bed and woke you up at 11 o'clock, but you always went to the midnight Pirates Ball. They didn't, and everybody stayed up till midnight, which they don't do anymore.
Yeah. Was the and Grand March at
the Grand time? March was always there, and everybody was in costume, and it was done at midnight, and it was always the last big thing of the season. It's kind of interesting that they've been able to keep that as a tradition thing, because it's, you know, it's kind of corny really in
today's
setup. But that was always the one costume party, and the Pirates Ball gave you the opportunity of coming in almost any kind of costume. But it was always a family affair. And there was no drinking at the club, you see, then.
Well, there wasn't any drinking at that time. That's right, well, yeah.
No.
Prohibition, so yeah.
Well, no, even after that, there wasn't any. See, that the liquor license was always held by the club was always owned by the golf club.
Yeah.
And the liquor license was held by the golf club, so they just said no liquor. Then you had the anchor room, and you got some beer in, but all that's pretty late. Then finally, you asked a question later whether there's more drinking going on now. Today, if you give a party, you almost have to give liquor. At that time, you didn't, but there was still as much drinking going on.
Was there any drug use back then that you know of?
I never knew of any drug. I mean, I'm a neophyte when it comes to drugs. I don't know of any drug use at that time. I mean, tobacco and cigarette, if you consider that a drug, and that was the drug, and
you smoked
that. Well, I never smoked a lot because I swam in college and you couldn't swim. But sure, everybody would sneak the cigarettes, and that's what you weren't supposed to do. But it wasn't really, I don't consider that a drug.
No.
I know a lot of people say so, but...
I guess it's all...
And there wasn't any marijuana. I don't think anybody knew what grass or marijuana was or anything like that.
What do you think about all those things?
Well, I think they ought to legalize them all. I think the consequences of the tremendous amount of money that's involved in it, the offshoot of all that is worse than the drugs themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think you'd have any more people using them than you do now. I don't think you'd cut it down any, but I don't think you'd have any more. But I mean, we'd corrupt the whole society. We'd corrupt all the police, the judges, the shootings, the prostitution, and
Prohibition, we're making the crooks rich.
Yeah, I think they ought to legalize it.
I think so.
And then educate people.
That's right.
As they've done with tobacco, see?
Yeah, yeah.
They've done that with tobacco. Sure, there's some people that smoke.
Morals has always been.
Yeah, and that's what they ought to do. And I think they could do it.
I think you're probably right. I think you are right. I think it couldn't be worse than it is now. Well, Jack, I think that's just
enough.
About it. And I thank you very much for your time.
Well, I hope, you know, you get to saying things you think people have said over and over again, but...
Well, I want to tell you, too, if you think of anything, I'm putting this tape aside,
yeah.
If you think of anything you want to add, please call me, and I mean
it. All right, okay.
And we can sit back down again,
right.
No problem, because you might come up with something that's, you know... It's the small things that we say offhand, I think, sometimes, that are the neatest things, the ones that, you know, just flow out.
I'd like to, if you talk to some people in Sylvan Beach who've been around for a while, things politically, political things. Was Sylvan Beach right or wrong when they didn't buy more Murray's Inn? They had an opportunity to buy that at one time.
Oh, I think that most of them feel that it was a big mistake
not
to, because it would have solved a lot of problems.
And, the other thing that I was always never could quite forgive Sylvan Beach, you know, about 10 years ago, I don't care. You can take this off. It isn't going to be that much interesting. So
we'll go ahead and just say it.
Yeah, I don't, you know, I'll say things whether I make people unhappy or not. It doesn't make a difference to me. But they had the government money to put a sewer system down, all down this lake and all over into Sylvan Beach, and so all of us would be connected to a sewer. And we had just built this house, and I'd built a sewer system over there, and I was all for doing this. I thought we ought to do it, but Sylvan voted down almost to a man not to spend the money to do it. And I never could understand that, because, you know, most people over there are, I don't say enlightened, but I mean, they've got some good sense and could see what was going to be done.
And
so consequently, we've never had a sewer system, and consequently, we've got a problem, you know, with
septic
going into it.
Yeah, I don't know why, except that maybe it might cost too much.
Well, that was obviously that was what it was. Yeah.
Sometimes those who have the most spend the least.
That's very true.
That's not necessarily always good.
That's very true. Maybe that's why they have the most.
That's right. That's probably why they have the most. And that's why they buy the camera to do the taping for them. You know, the ones that have the least. Well, Jack, I thank you very much. And it's been a pleasure. And I
hope something
used to do. Oh, no. Some of that stuff was great.